Christ is risen. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
Welcome to Clough United Methodist Church. We are glad you are here in worship with us this morning, where you are invited to come, connect, grow, and serve your roadmap to meaningful purpose. You are welcome here. No matter where you come from, no matter where you're going, no matter what you believe or doubt, no matter what you have or don't have, and no matter whom you love, you are welcomed here this day by a God who loves you, who knows you by name, and who wants a personal relationship with you. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. It is Easter Sunday, a day to celebrate the risen Christ. So let us join in these centering words. Christ is risen, bringing joy, hope, and the promise of new life. May this day be a celebration of God's abiding presence in our lives and in our world. Please stand as you are able as we begin our worship in prayer and praise. Praise and prayer.
The Lord is risen today. Thank you.
Amen. Let us pray. O God of all our days, we come this morning with eager anticipation. We seek to know you, to see you, to touch you. Open our hearts that we might experience you anew. Open our lives that we might be faithful witnesses to your resurrection. May we, with shouts of joy, proclaim your steadfast, liberating love to all people everywhere. Amen. 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 You may be seated as the children come forward for our A Moment with Children.
Good morning. All right. So did anybody get to do any fun Easter egg hunts or get Easter eggs anytime recently? Yeah? All right. Well, I have an Easter egg there for everybody. If you guys want to pass that around, you can all take an egg. Sebastian, you want to come get an egg? All right, everybody got an egg? Now go ahead and open it. What is your face telling everybody, Isaiah? It's empty. Is that disappointing? All right, so can you think of something else that was empty on Easter that we celebrate? There we go. The tomb, right? Because remember, Jesus was crucified and died, and then they buried him in a tomb. But on Easter, the tomb was empty, right? Because he's risen again. All right, so an empty Easter egg might be disappointing, but an empty tomb is amazing. So an angel told the ladies who went to go see Jesus that he had risen from the dead and he was alive. They were so excited, they ran to tell his disciples. And for Christians, Easter is even better than Christmas. Not only was Jesus born, but he lived and died and came back to life. All right, so we're going to say a prayer. Put your hands together. Dear God, thank you for sacrificing your son for our sins. Thank you for saving us and for your love. We have the hope in Easter. Help us share that with others. Thank you for your son, Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. And you guys can come to Children's Church.
We have two scripture readings today. First one is from Luke 24, verses 1 through 12, the empty tomb. Very early in the morning, on the first day of the week, the women went to the tomb, bringing the fragrant spices they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. They didn't know what to make of this. Suddenly, two men were standing beside them in gleaming, bright clothing. The women were frightened and bowed their faces towards the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He isn't here, but has been raised. Remember what he told you while he was still in Galilee, that the human one must be handed over to the sinners, be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words. When they returned to the tomb, they reported all these things to the 11 and all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. Their words struck the apostles as nonsense, and they didn't believe the women. But Peter ran to the tomb, When he bent over to look inside, he saw only the linen cloth. Then he returned home, wondering what had happened. Second reading is Acts 10, verses 34 to 43. Peter said, "I really am learning that God doesn't show partiality to one group of people over another. Rather, in every nation, whoever worships him and does what is right is acceptable to him. This is the message of peace he sent to the Israelites by proclaiming the good news through Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. You know what happened throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism John preached. You know about Jesus of Nazareth, whom God appointed with the Holy Spirit and endowed with power. Jesus traveled around doing good and healing everyone oppressed by the devil because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him up on the third day and allowed him to be seen, not by everyone, but by us. We are witnesses whom God chose beforehand, who ate and drank with him after God raised him from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name." The word of God for the people of God.
Our song of response is "Because He Lives."
Thank you.
Well, my sermon title this morning is Wondering What Had Happened. And I'm just going to tell you that this probably seems a little odd, but at any rate, when I read this Luke version of the resurrection, in that last sentence, but Peter ran to the tomb, and when he ran to the tomb, and when he bent over to look inside, he saw only the linen cloth. Then he returned home, wondering what had happened. Now, this is in the Common English Bible. In the New Revised Standard Version, it says he was amazed at what had happened. And I was thinking that, you know, there's a lot of us that are amazed. I mean, who has seen a resurrected body in 2022, right? I mean, so resurrection times can be a hard concept to understand. There are some people that can't understand the virgin birth. There's others that can't understand the resurrection of the dead. So it fell on me, wondering what had happened. And I'm identifying, it's like, who would I be in this text? Huh? Would I be one of the women with spices, you know, that's coming early to, you know, rewrap his body and put the spices in? Or would I be the impetuous Peter, right? Running, and I'm looking, and there's no body, and there's gray clothes, and, you know, it's like, well, what's this about? So anyway, the Easter story piques our curiosity. None of us postmoderns enter the story from the human side. We are not curious about a missing body. We are not curious about the influence of Jesus on the Jews. We are, though, quite curious about the resurrection. We know about the empty tomb. We are at some level of spiritual curiosity, wondering what a resurrected Christ means to us. Now, the thing is, we know about the empty tomb, but some of us don't even know what that tomb looked like. I don't know how many people have had a trip to the Holy Land. Anyone here? Yes. And so they take, you know, you can go to an excursion to a tomb, and it's carved out of rock, and you got to bend down to get in. And then there's two chambers, and in the one chamber is a slab where the body would be. You know, it's not like, I don't know what we would think, but it's not like how we do funerals, right? That there's a hole in the ground. No, this is altogether different. So it is, and there's, you carve out the opening, and so there has to be something to cover the opening, right? So so I just want you to, you gotta like get into the story and understand the context of what they're talking about, because it's so foreign to us, right? So in Luke's gospel, then, the empty tomb is met by perplexity, and the strange appearance of two luminous men produce terror. Terror and amazement and sadness also mark responses to the empty tomb in the other gospel narratives. Now, this narrative is not as popular. Most of us like that John narrative, right, where Mary Magdalene's there, and then, you know, Jesus shows himself, you know, in the garden. She mistakes him for a gardener. Many of us know that. But this text where, you know, it's the women and just Peter, we're not familiar with this one. And so I'm glad that, and I chose this one to speak on today. Now, the other gospel narratives all speak about the resurrection, but it's just like anything else. If you're a witness, you know, and there's four witnesses seeing an event, you're going to have four sort of interpretations, right? So you need to just understand that that's what is going on here. So the early morning events on that first day of the week are not greeted with joyous cries of, Christ is risen! He is risen indeed! The first indication of what is happening comes from the men in those dazzling clothes. Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. So what does the resurrection mean? That the dead and buried Jesus is risen and alive remains perplexing to contemporary congregations unless it's accompanied by remembering all that had gone before in Jesus' acts and words. Like Peter, we are amazed and left wondering about what had happened, because none of the gospel renderings of this event speak to the mechanics of the actual movement of Jesus' descent into hell and his subsequent ascent into his heavenly realm. Okay, folks, there was no scribes there, right? There was no one down in hell taking notes to tell you how Jesus was talking to them, what he was saying, you know, if he was trying to redeem some other people, and then he went to heaven. There's no one. So we don't know what happened, and the gospel texts don't tell us. That's why everyone is amazed, right? And pondering and wondering, what does this mean? So there is no one there, like I said, to take notes. But what we have, though, are testimonies of witnesses, of women, and let me just digress and say it was all in every gospel, it was the women who were there first. I'm just saying. You know? You know, I was sharing at Cherry Grove that I had a meme come across my Facebook, and one of the pastors said, I think it should be only the women pastors that are proclaiming the word this Sunday. I'm just saying. But there's just not enough of us, all right? So anyway, so they're the witness. The women are the first witnesses, the apostles and the disciples of the risen Christ. So what does Jesus' resurrection mean? His death and resurrection means Jesus died for our sin, which died with him. When he rose, so did our hope. Quoting Max Lucado, for when he rose, our grave was changed from a final residence to temporary housing. Yet on this particular day, according to Luke, the women bow in terrified awe at the empty tomb. The body of their teacher is gone, and the appearance of two strangely bright men is fairly unlikely that in that moment the women were embracing hope. Yet we, who are accustomed to this story, who are used to thinking of Jesus as our good buddy, you know, we have tried to make God as knowable and dependable as breakfast cereal. We hardly linger at the dreadful silence of these women with their faces in the dirt and these angelic or these glittering men standing above them, right? Our efforts to tame the holy inure us to their fear. We miss Luke's first lesson in this account. God's ways are not our ways. Can I get an amen? Amen. All right. They are beyond human comprehension. They subvert what we expect. They demand the impossible. They are holy precisely because they are not of our own making. Now, Luke's second, I love that. Come on now. All right. Luke's second lesson comes. Why do you look for the living among the dead? Now, listen, we are just as guilty of such fruitless search. We, too, want to tend to the corpse of long dead ideas and ideals. As long as we hold on to them too long, we grasp our loved ones too tightly, refusing to allow them to change, to become bigger or smarter or stronger. Huh? We choose to stay with what we know in our hearts to be dead because it's safe, it's malleable, and so susceptible to burnishing through private memory. The words of the bright messengers are a challenge to stop hanging on to the dead and move into new life. Amen. Amen. They are reminders that the Holy One dwells wherever new life bursts forth. Finally, The third lesson from Luke is also found in the mouths of those shiny angelic beings. Remember how he told you, they tell the women, that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and on the third day rise again. This memory connects the empty tomb to the very human Jesus who ate and talked and died. In Alan Culpepper's words, remember what Jesus had done and what he had taught. Remember the meals in Jesus' fellowship, his healings and his parables. You know, the bent over woman and the 10 lepers. Would you understand the meaning of the empty tomb? He asked. Well, just remember Galilee. Now, the admonition to remember grounds the mystery of resurrection in the everyday world of human living, as well as in the demanding communal ethic that Jesus taught. This means that the boundless gift of the empty tomb cannot be separated from the words and the actions of Jesus. Resurrection, after all, is not some buoyant ideal unconnected to the real world. It is the invitation, hear this, people, it's an invitation to live as Jesus lived, a doorway to a life in which meals are shared with enemies. Healing is offered to the hopeless. Prophetic challenges are issued to the powerful. So quoting Max Lucado again, at every age in history, on every page of scripture, the truth is revealed. God allows us to make our own choices. God gives eternal choices, and these choices have eternal consequences. We get to choose how we're going to live. If we allow our curiosity and concern about worldly matters to control us, we may miss the opportunity offered by God. The risen Christ is calling our names. The risen Christ calls us to a spiritual level of curiosity to receive the gift of eternal life. Now, lastly, while Peter was amazed and pondering on the events of the empty tomb, we find him in his last sermon in Acts, realizing something essential about God. He has always lived in relationship. God does not show partiality or favor. Amen? Rather, God offers restoration and salvation to all people, Jews and Gentiles alike. And I'd just like to remind everybody that we're the Gentiles. Am I right? Jews and Gentiles alike. And the thing is, the news of God's impartial love is not just abstract information about God. It places a clear demand on us to love impartially as God loves. You hear that, saints? To love impartially as God loves. There isn't any person on earth that God does not love. There isn't any person on earth that can't be redeemed by God's love. Do you hear me? No one is beyond the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen? Amen. 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 So the Easter message for us all is the truth that because this man Jesus was raised from the dead, your sins and my sins are forgiven and our lives can be changed forever. Amen and amen.
Our song of response is Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Will you stand as you feel led and join with the praise team?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
May be seated. Throughout his life, Jesus required us to respond to the challenges he put before the people. And he challenges us still today, having heard the resurrection message, what will our response be? The first that we are called to is to respond with faith. So let us proclaim our faith as is written in the Apostles' Creed and contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testament. Let us join in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our next act of response is a call to turn away from that which leads us away from Christ and turn towards Christ. This is something we call confession or repentance, a turning. So will you join in this prayer of confession? Holy, holy, holy God, as we draw near to the mouth of the tomb and find the stone rolled away, as we bend with racing hearts to look inside, we are struck dumb. All our words are as prattle before the awe and majesty of your power. In silence, we bow before you, for we have fallen short of the glory for which you created us. Lord, have mercy upon us and make us worthy to be called your own. In the empty tomb, God declares that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing we have done or left undone. No one whom we have been or failed to be. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Alleluia, alleluia, amen. Praise be to God.
I'd like you to join me in the great Thanksgiving prayer for Easter as we prepare to celebrate Holy Communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth, and love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and became subject to evil and death, your love remained steadfast. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Easter feast that renewed by your word and sacraments, and fervent in prayer and works of justice and mercy, we may come to the fullness of grace that you have prepared for those who love you. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from the slavery of sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. By your great mercy, we have been born anew to a living hope through the resurrection of your Son from the dead and to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. Once we were no people, but now we are your people, declaring your wonderful deeds in Christ, who called us out of the darkness into his marvelous light. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." On the day that you raised him from the dead, he was recognized by his disciples in the breaking of the bread. And in the power of the Holy Spirit, your church has continued in the breaking of the bread and the sharing of the cup. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. May they be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen and amen. The communion is an open communion. This is the Lord's table. We will offer communion by intention, where a piece of bread is broken and dipped. You do not like that, we have the little cups with the wafer, and you may choose to use that if you do not want to have communion by intention.
And gluten-free.
And we do also have gluten-free option. Amen.
Thank you.
in the peace and presence of Christ. Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks for uniting us as the body of Christ and for filling us with joy at this table. Lead us toward the unity of your church and help us treasure signs of reconciliation. Now that we have tasted the banquet you have prepared for us, may we one day feast together in your heavenly city. Through Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end. Amen. Will you stand as you feel led for our closing song, This is Amazing Grace?